Good morning, everyone. So I'll be speaking on congenital nasolacrimal duct obstruction management options. So we all know that CNLDO is the most commonest cause of epiphora in children's, and the incidence is in the various studies have ranged from 1 to even 30%. So diagnosis is straightforward, but you have to rule out many other diseases, intraocular diseases. It classically, the children's have epiphora, discharge, and matting of eyelashes. These symptoms usually sets within a month, and luckily the most of the children's, around 90%, they tend to resolve by 1 year of age. The diagnosis is based on these signs, that is regurgitation on pressure over lacrimal sac, tear meniscus height, and fluorescent dye disappearance test. So when coming on to the management, the knowing about the history, that is the spontaneous resolution, is very important. This is a landmark paper which was published in IE in 1991, which actually predicted that at that particular age, how many of the children will resolve by 1 year of age. So if a child comes in a clinic around 3 months of age, so it can be predicted that there are chances that 90% that the symptoms will resolve by 1 year. This actually keeps on decreasing as the age increases, and the paper showed that, you know, beyond the by the 1 year of age, the chances of resolution are very low, near to zero. So for the initial the management for the children's, basically who are less than 1 year old, the sac compression is suggested, which actually has a role in hastening the recovery of the CNLDO. So it depends upon the technique and the compliance, that how you teach your the parents to how to do it, perform on the children's, and it is probably effective till 9 to 12 months of the age. Antibiotics are not necessary, in just in cases of acute infection they are indicated, and the simple cleaning of the discharge with the cotton swab is indicated. So this is what I gave the patients, the parents told that how to perform the sac compression and certain do's and don'ts. Basically, the parents should wash their hand. The duration of the massage is like 4 sessions in a day, press 10 times over the lacrimal sac area. They should not be moving downwards or, you know, rotating their fingers over the incorrect area. So that parent education is very important, and in the clinic, when the parents say come with child, should actually demonstrate yourself, and then ask the parents to demonstrate to you to how to perform the sac compression completely. If the symptoms are not resolving, that is by maybe 9 to 12 months of age, irrigation and probing is indicated. We do from upper punctum, dilate it first, and then pass the probe along the vertical canaliculus and then the horizontal canaliculus. When you encounter a bony stop, then you have to bring over the probe in line with the trochlea and press it down. So classically, this is the probing that which is being done. We rely on Springback test if you are in the nasolacrimal duct correctly, and metal to metal touch. So you can confirm and do the irrigation later on. So there are various methods, adjuvants in addition to the probing, basically the intubation and balloon decoroplasty that has been described in the literature. But what they suggest that even if you compare all these in a primary case of CNLDO, the success rate is not much different. So basically that is a lacuna in literature, that you are giving a blanket treatment to even all of the children's without knowing the cause. So we know that variations, CNLDO have various variations. This is a textbook picture from Jones. We mostly see a simple CNLDO, which is has a high success rate with a simple probing. But what is more important are these complex variants, actually, which needs a particular customized approach. So there are types of the CNLDO which are diagnosed intraoperatively only. Get to know that whether they are simple or the complex, and if there is any more variants to the complex. So actually, yes, there are various variants which has been described, and luckily some of them are amenable to the treatment with the endoscopy. So this is the outcome in the simple, has a high success rate, both the anatomical and the functional with the simple probing. But with the complex, even if you use the endoscope, there are the success rate is around 50% to 60%. So now the approach has changed even to the one-stage obstruction-based theory by the Kashkoli, which actually they take up as a child of the CNLDO on table and decide what actually should be given, like how to manage that particular type of obstruction on table. And if there is a bony obstruction or the complete absence of the DCR can be performed then and only itself. So you have to choose the right for your patients. So I'll just show some of the videos here of the endoscopic management of the probing. So this is a case of a simple obstruction. So this is a child with right-sided nasolacrimal duct obstruction. So this is a 2.7 millimeter endoscope. On the right side, there is a septum. Above that convex structure is the inferior turbinate, and below that is the lateral wall of the nose. So nasolacrimal duct opening lies about a centimeter posterior to the ala of the nose, and there you can see the probe coming seen. So you have to go ahead and see that area below the inferior turbinate, and for that usually we need to push the inferior turbinate up with some spatula. So a periosteum elevator can be used to look and go into that area. Now you can see that the probe is seen visible there, and it's a straightforward passage. There is nothing, no pathology there. So this is a case of a like simple obstruction. We can confirm that probe is now inside, and you can do the fluorescein guide irrigation later on. So let's see some of the complex obstruction, how they look on the nasal endoscopy. So we know that impacted inferior turbinate is a case where the inferior turbinate is actually very lateralized and is a kind of adhered to the lateral wall of the nose. So actually this term is actually a misnomer, and they are actually better described as a lateralized inferior turbinate. So you need to medialize them so that you can see the area of the nasolacrimal duct opening followed by the probe. So this compared to the other, you can see some redundant mucosa from where the probe is coming. So this case will need a tilting of a probe, maybe a 45 degree. You have to slit open the entire mucosal fold if you have to achieve the high success rate. So there are cases, now a buried probe has been identified. It is actually the condition where the entire nasolacrimal duct remains submucosally in the lateral wall of the nose up to the even floor. So let's come on to the video that how do we go about in buried probe externalization. So again, this was actually a child with twice failed probing, and on endoscopically, we can see the this is actually a left side nose, inferior turbinate there. So when you pass a probe in such cases, the probe will remain buried inside the mucosa. It will not just simple come out as you saw in the previous videos. So you can see the movement in the submucosal plane actually. So once that we lift the inferior turbinate up, and you can now see that probe is lying submucosally. So this is again, you have to perforate that membrane with the specialized tilting of the probe, and you can see then after that they being done, the purulent discharge can be seen. So you have to again, this opening has to be entirely from superior to the inferior till the entire length of the buried probe. So the buried probe, usually they are seen in the later children's, and may if endoscopic guided probing is done, they have a high success rate. So next, let's just see the complex variant is that is seen is the Dacryocel. So it is typically seen in the children. They may be newborn or they usually develop within a week of born, and it is a bluish cystic swelling. So what is now known is that these cysts are actually associated with intranasal cysts, which can be very large and small also. The small one, they are actually difficult to manage and pick up on the endoscopy, whereas a large one, they are not good for the children. They can cause respiratory insufficiency. So this is our last video. This is again a child of left side CNLDO. Had a probing done, but the symptoms persisted. So externally, there was no actually Dacryocel, but there was a small intranasal cyst when the inferior turbinate was lifted up. So we managed this cyst by giving two perpendicular cruciate incisions over the cyst. This is a cyst, you can see a mucosal fold bulge there. And then with a special instrument, a sickle knife, we give a two perpendicular incision. So this is a first incision, horizontal incision, which is being given. And next we give a second incision perpendicular to it, so that the cyst marsupializes. Sometimes there may be too much redundant mucosa, especially in the large Dacryocel. So you have to pull out the some of the mucosa with the forceps also. So after this, we just confirm that the cyst has marsupialized and the dye is getting drained into the nose. So there are various factors which affect the success rate. Basically, with the old age, the complex obstruction, they tend to accumulate, and that's why the success decreases as a child gets older. Also, there are cases which have a bilateral affection. They have known to have a low success rate with a failed probing, with the atonic sac. Also, the chances of probing getting treated with the probing are less. So, use of adjunctives is actually it makes the procedure costly. And may not be required, may be unnecessary if you are properly doing the nasal endoscopy guided probing along the primary time itself. So, I'd like to conclude that there are you should know the various variants of the CNLDO, and that's how you manage them. Only the diagnosis can be made intraoperatively and should be ready with the solution to find out that how that particular type you can treat it with the endoscopically. So actually the DCR is now the success of the higher success of the nasal endoscopy guided probing, the DCR is may not be needed much in many children. Thank you. Yes.
Thank you, Dr. Saurabh. So one question I had is, till what age would you try probing, and after what age would you consider a DCR in a child with CNLDO?
Yeah, so lower limit is like 1 year, but
what's the upper limit that you would consider?
Upper limit can be beyond even 5 years. We usually have read like 4 to 5 years, we can manage them, but even the older children's, like maybe around above which we talk about more than 4 years, they still have a 50% chance. So the one thing is that at we should know important is the atonicity, which develops over the time. So that is like is the predictor that the probing is not likely to succeed. So in those cases you need DCR.
So maybe after 4 years.
I have like managed even like 8 year children with a probe. If that is done,
maybe
you can give a trial.
Give a trial on table.
Travel
and
table,
if
and
it works fine.
Yeah, then
otherwise
convert.
If it doesn't work, then you can always
convert on the DCR.
Table. So
yeah,
you need to
yeah.
counsel the patients accordingly.
Yeah, yeah, that's all.
So Dr. Savri
what
wants to ask everybody, what's the oldest child you've treated with probing?
Mine is was 7, and then recently we tried a 9-year-old bilateral. So one got done, but one is now pending for DCR. 9.
10 years.
9. Okay.
Dr. Anirban has done.
As all of you agree, is that we offer probing as a first step and then convert to DCR if it doesn't work. It worked and we didn't have to proceed.
Mine is 8 years late. I mean, eldest is 8 years.
But successful?
Yeah, it worked. It worked in that.
But two more than one probing, na?
I think when I was in LVPI, I think
only probing, one single probing.
One single.
Yeah.
A 12-year-old child we also treated with a probing.
But
So,
but the patient but was counseled for the need for DCR also. So.
And did you stent it for older children? Do you stent it, or depending on your inference, you decide?
No, no. I generally don't stent unless it's a recurrent case.
Okay.
If it's a case of failed probing earlier, then only.
Thank you for the lecture. Do you try probing with intubation before applying DCR? Intubation.
Yeah, that actually depends upon what the type of obstruction. If there is like diffuse nasal lacrimal duct stenosis, or there are like multiple level blocks, valvular blocks, post sac obstruction, or if there is a sac atonicity, if you anatomically and it is patent duct, then you can do the intubation in these cases. But these are actually quite rare, especially if you see these case of scenarios in already like failed probing. Because of maybe the previous attempt, the stenosis has happened, diffuse stenosis or multiple level obstruction.
So how many times you do probing before intubation? How many times you repeat probing before intubation?
Only one time. You can decide on table, like if you diagnose the obstruction, like what exactly it is.
Yeah.
So a simple probing like without intubation will work. If there is there are these indications for like balloon or intubation, you can put that in the first go itself,
yeah.
And then wait for the resolution. That duct, I think, if you're putting the tube, then two, three months later on, you can remove it.
Saurav, I think what she wants to say is, if you have a successful probing and then the child has recurrence of symptoms, what would you do next?
I will again do the second probing and see what actually is the cause of the failure. So there might be like the videos I showed, there might be like these cysts or which has like, they can again close back, or a buried probe like that opening you created. So you have to diagnose that what is the cause of the failure and then treat accordingly. Yeah, if it is anatomically patent, if I am being able to do probing and demonstrate that, yeah, it is anatomically patent, then the point comes of putting the tube. If that is not because of there may be some diffuse stenosis of the duct and the probe is not visible, or if there is a misdirected probe second time, then I think, there is no point will be intubation.
So just to answer that question, so my pediatric ophthalmologist is trained from another institute than me. And he puts a stent for every patient he probes. And the ones we do together, it's not required based on the inference, then I don't put it. So we also have that thing between us. But what works is that similar to this, I only stent it if it's a repeat probing. And at that probe, I feel I need to put it in, not in the primary.
Like in recently, I got a case of a failed probing. So what actually was done for the initial probing was a misdirected. So when I just put the probe and saw it through the endoscope, it was not coming from the normal opening. So it was misdirected coming near the inferior turbinate more. And actually, at the nasolacrimal duct opening, there was a cyst. So once I marsupialized the cyst, my probe was not going into that cystic area. It was actually misdirected. But on the syringing, it was patent. So if you like diagnose the cause then of the failure, then you can treat them. I personally not use intubation, and balloon is out of so intubation in very, very less. I have done, I think, maybe one or two cases till now over my like 3 to 4 years.
Thank you, Dr. Saurabh. That was very nice. Next.